On the 29th of February 2024, Ford became the first company to make the Tesla adapter available to its customers, free of cost until the 30th of June. With a number of OEMs to follow with passing time, this will surely ease the DC charging needs of many non-Tesla users. Having said that, here on this channel, we have always emphasized on the importance of good level 2 public charging networks. And in this video, we are examining the potential of developing level 2 public charging as that daily available option around the corner from home. We are also looking at the potential in the enormous parking lots available with large commercial light industrial properties here in the US. Places like grocery stores, retailers, movie theaters are often in the midst of large parking spaces, and these we believe represent a boundless opportunity. We will also look at the barriers to developing public AC charging, more with some strange power distribution factors here in the US, and we query the possible workarounds to them. So let's get into it. By some estimates, there are over 500 plus million parking spaces in commercial lots around the US. Probably 700 million to 2 billion total parking spaces. The broader parking industry is a fragmented one, probably in the north of $100 billion, and which is probably flat in growth, with the exception of specific locations like healthcare facilities and events. To us, they mean a well-designated spot around 18 feet by 9 feet that could hold a valuable electric vehicle charging dispenser, and where people could easily top up 7 to 10 kilowatt hours of energy or 20 to 30 miles of driving range per hour in the time when the vehicle is stationary. This is highly valuable real estate. AC charging is also far more conducive for the batteries. On an aggregate, this will also reduce the load on the DC fast charging infrastructure and by extension on the grids. Level 2 AC charging is far more energy efficient than DC charging, especially when considering the energy losses associated with converting AC power to DC power. In AC charging, the conversion from AC to DC typically occurs within the vehicle's onboard charger, which can be more efficient compared to external DC chargers. AC charging stations are more universal and compatible with a wide range of electric vehicles. Most EVs come equipped with onboard AC chargers, which means they can be charged using AC charging stations. DC charging stations, on the other hand, may not be compatible with all EV models due to different standards and power requirements. In the US, most use the J1772 port, barring Tesla. Tesla users get a free J1772 adapter, and going forward, all the OEMs may implement the Tesla J3400 or NACS connector. It's also cheaper, flexible in installation and convenient, particularly for slow overnight charging. It's less likely to strain the electrical grid, making it easier to integrate into existing infrastructure without significant upgrades. Level 2 AC charging stations strategically placed in US retail parking lots hold immense potential. Slow AC charging is generally considered gentler on the battery compared to rapid DC charging. While DC charging is convenient for long distance travel or quick top-ups, frequent use of fast chargers can potentially degrade the battery more quickly due to higher heat generation and charging rates. AC charging, especially at lower power levels, may also preserve battery longevity over the long term. Let's now look at some benefits that retail parking lots hold for AC public charging networks. Retail parking lots are frequented by consumers for shopping and leisure activities. Integrating charging stations into these spaces adds convenience for EV owners, allowing them to charge their vehicles going about their daily routines. Retail parking lots typically have extended dwell times, with vehicles parked for an average of 1 to 2 hours. This duration aligns well with the charging times required for level 2 AC chargers, enabling EV users to replenish their vehicle batteries while shopping or dining. Retail parking lots often feature amenities such as restrooms, food outlets, and recreational areas. Installing charging stations in these locations enhances the overall customer experience, encouraging longer stays and repeat visits. Retail establishments are distributed across urban, suburban, and rural areas, ensuring broad coverage of charging infrastructure. This geographical distribution promotes EV adoption by providing charging access to a diverse range of consumers. If you would like to see our rating of the top 5 electric vehicle supply equipment or EVAC units for home charging, you can check that video here. Though parking lots hold huge potential as AC public charging destinations, there are also some important issues to look into. The installation of charging infrastructure requires upfront investment, including equipment procurement, installation, and ongoing maintenance. Public-private partnerships and government incentives can help alleviate these costs and encourage private businesses to invest in charging infrastructure. There are issues to keep in mind: retrofitting charging solutions over the existing infrastructure built years ago and not with these kinds of needs in mind. And here is one. Most commercial light industrial properties are delivered 480 volt three-phase power from the utility. That power is then stepped down into different voltages as required using property-owned transformers, most commonly in three-phase 240 volt circuits. Most of these transformers are typically installed for regular loads and not something as specialized as electric vehicle charging. Let's look at an illustration. A typical light industrial property in the US receives a reasonably hefty three-phase 480 volt by 225 amp service. That's 108 kilowatts. The property then installs a 75 kilowatt on-property transformer that steps down the three-phase 480 volt to a three-phase 240 volt. From there, it creates circuits for the loads as required. When the property decides to provide for electric vehicle charging, it makes it of a three-phase 240 volt circuit. That's unlike a home, where a split single-phase service is common, rather mandated. In a split single-phase circuit present at homes, one line offers 120 volt and connecting the two lines brings 240 volts. But in a three-phase 240 volt connecting the lines in any way delivers only 208 volts as you see in this chart. This is the offset lost on a three-phase line, reducing the potential power available to the vehicle. So were the electric vehicle charging setup to be created at the point where the utility's three-phase 480 volt service connects to the property, that is 277 volt with the offset, the network would probably be able to charge twice the number of EVs in comparison to setting it up after the property owned three-phase 240 volt transformer that holds only 208 volts. That makes four different voltage options: 480, 277, 208 and 120 in voltage, but none the favored 240 volt. There are several such aspects that ingrain the goal of setting reliable charging. This was but a single illustration to give the viewers an idea of the effort. These places need to be incentivized, and not for undertaking the necessary upgrades and installations alone, but to also keep them up and running. As a matter of fact, they may benefit from the wide and innumerable incentives currently in place for the most part. If you would like to see our video on the Tesla Universal Wall Connector, you can check that video here. Scaling up the charging infrastructure can strain the electrical grids. Smart grids and upgrading the infrastructure may be a solution in cases. Clear regulatory guidelines are essential to facilitate the deployment of the charging infra in retail parking lots. Streamlining the permitting process and standardizing technical requirements can expedite installation and ensure interoperability across different charging networks. Though we have checked this in a number of places, we would welcome any thoughts, inputs, or exceptions that you may want to share. And please do so in the comments. And we would also like to hear from you on your thoughts on this, about things you observed and experiences that you would like to share with the available spaces that you see and places that do offer charging and the experiences around them. If you would like to see our follow-up video on the Rivian R2, its comparison with its competition and the other existing Rivian cars, click here or in the description. See you in the next one.